when I ask our song leader if they know a song and can lead a song, that I have a song. It's a song that we all know very well. That is really the thrust of this morning's lesson, is singing the lost. Jacob was the unique spin on the lost, and in identifying who the lost really could be. And so we're going to look at James chapter 5, verses 19 and 20. Two powerful verses that really serve to sum up really all of this letter of James. It's an unusual ending to a letter. We don't end our letters this way.
Gotta love the technology. Can you hear me now? A little better? So James is talking about one who's been in truth and now one who is straying from the truth. But he's also talking about the one who puts forth the effort to go and to bring him back. It's a lot like the commandment that Jesus gave in John chapter 15 and verse John 15 verse 13, when Jesus said, "A new commandment I give you, that you love one another." And then Jesus goes on to describe the depth of that kind of love, and he says, "Greater love has no one than this, than he lay down his life for his friends." Greater love has nobody, has no one than this. Then he lay down his life for his friends. And certainly when we talk about somebody laying down their lives for their friends, Jesus is at the forefront, because that's exactly what he did. But you and I must do the same thing as well. Because when it comes to the salvation of one another, we are God's agent in the salvation of that person. We're almost like a special agent of God. You know, there's a craze today over these comics. And you have people like Captain America and Thor. You've got a 7-year-old young boy in this audience who is captivated by the sermon right now. Iron Man and all of those superheroes that go to great lengths. I mean, they'll fly around the world as Superman would to save somebody who is in peril, because they're special agents. They're superheroes. We need people like that of faith. We need that same idea, the same concept of people who are in peril because they've wandered from the truth. And they need a spiritual superhero to come and rescue them. And that's us. That's us. He says, "My brethren, if any among you stray," and one turns him back. You see, there's an emphasis on the one who does the turning, not the one who strays. And so in this craze of superheroes, we need to be God's superheroes. We need to be those special agents. And really, this could be a summarization of the entire letter of James. James has already identified how many different ways people could stray from the truth. He's given us instructions on faith itself and how we use our faith. And that's what this has all been about. How do we use our faith? Well, one of the ways we do that is by going and reaching out to brethren who have strayed, maybe have fallen, gotten caught up in the cares of the world, distracted from the faith, and they need to be restored. There's risk, though. There's risk. He says, brethren, which incidentally, it's the 16th time in this letter that James has used the word brethren. It's interesting the emphasis he places on this relationship that we have with one another. But that a brother or sister can stray from the truth. And he says, if it's any among you, any among the brethren who are straying from the truth. And so they're going from the truth. You can't go away from anything unless you've already been in there. You can't stray from the truth unless you've already been in the truth. You can't stray from home unless you've already lived at home. And so he's talking about these brethren who have believed in the truth, who have obeyed the truth, and now have wandered away from the truth. It's a tremendous risk because it seems as though salvation is at stake. Because when you look at the outcome of the one who goes and brings him back, James says you save his soul from death, spiritual death, and eternal separation from God. Because God is truth, isn't he? And we need to be in truth. And death implies that loss of salvation. But that idea of straying from the truth leads to sin. James says in chapter 1, look at chapter 1, verses beginning in verse 13. Let no one say when he is tempted, I'm being tempted by God, for God cannot be tempted by evil. And he himself does not tempt anyone. But each one is tempted when he's carried away. You see, here's the idea of wandering. He's carried away. He's enticed by his own lust. And when lust has conceived, it gives birth to sin. And when sin is accomplished, it brings forth death. And that's what James is worried about here. When somebody wanders from the truth because they get caught up in their own desires, their own lusts, their own passions, they're tempted to sin, and sin leads to that death. And James wants the faithful brethren to go and search and rescue those who are wandering, those who are straying. Because as James identifies here, the straying brethren are the sinners. He says, he who turns a sinner from the error of his ways, the straying brethren are in error. To be in error means that you've wandered from the truth, and to wander from the truth means that you've wandered into error. Well, that's dangerous, don't you think? Tremendous risk. In Hebrews chapter 10 and verse 26, the writer talks about one who would go on sinning willfully, intentionally, without any thought, without any reservation, but the one who just goes on sinning because that's what he likes to do, the writer of Hebrews says there no longer remains a sacrifice for sin. Because no longer is Jesus' blood covering your sin. In 1 John chapter 1, verses 7 through 9, he says, in verse 7 he says, if we walk in the light as he himself is in the light, we have fellowship one with another, and the blood of his son cleanses us from all unrighteousness. Well, that blood, that sacrifice, no longer covers the one who is wandering and sinning willfully. He's given up on what Jesus has done for him, and he's been intent on living the life he wants to live. And it's the one who's wandered from the truth who foregoes that sacrifice for sin. What's encouraging is our Bible gives us some preventive medicine. In Ephesians chapter 4, Paul talks about this medicine that we can have, because all of us need to grow up, right? I mean, I need to grow up. I knew there was going to be an amen there. Okay? But we all need to grow up. And listen, the beauty of it is that it doesn't matter how long we've been a Christian. It doesn't matter how old we are. We still need to be growing, don't we? I mean, Peter says to grow in the grace and the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. 2 Peter 3:18. We need to grow in that grace and knowledge. And when do we arrive? Maybe the day we get home. To heaven, that is. And so Paul says that we need to grow up so that we're not carried about by the deceitful scheming, by the craftiness, by the cunningness, by every wind of doctrine that blows through town. Because some of it will sound appealing. And Paul says you can't be captivated by that. That's why James says the truth is so important. The problem is, the challenge is, we live in a day and age where people don't accept such thing as absolute truth. Because what's true for you, well, that's good for you. But I don't believe that. I believe something else, and that's truth for me. And that's got to be okay. If that's true, then there is no such thing as absolute truth. Jesus said in John 17 and verse 17, sanctify them by the truth. Jesus said that God's word is truth. That is truth. And so we've got to come to understand how important this idea of truth is, and how risky it is to wander away from it. I mean, think about this. How many of you would play a pickup game of football right on the southern rim of the Grand Canyon? How many of you are going to play that game? Your friends get together and say, hey, look, there's some open space here. There are no railings. But there's a 3,000-foot drop. Let's play football. How many of you are going to get into that? Because it's what? Too risky. It's too dangerous. So why would we play around with the faith? Why would we play around with truth that way? Because just as surely as you would die from a 3,000-foot drop on the southern rim of the Grand Canyon, you will die when you wander away from God's truth. So why mess around? Why play with it? Now, here's the other caveat. This is the response that we are to have. This is how faithful brethren are to react. When you see somebody playing football by the edge of the Grand Canyon, you ought to give them a little bit of a warning. You ought to approach them and say, you guys realize how risky this is? You guys realize how dumb it is to play this close to danger? And think of how we do that spiritually. Because we come up with a lot of excuses for this. Okay? We use excuses like, you know, if somebody's lost in the woods, and we've seen this happen, we've seen hikers get lost in the mountains here in Southern California. And you'll see a whole mass of people that will go out and start searching for them. People who don't even know the one that's lost. And they'll join the search party, and they'll go all over. They'll scour the mountains. They take the dogs. They take the helicopters so that they can find the one that's lost. But can you imagine somebody say, then knock on your door, look, somebody's lost in the mountains. Can you come and help? Well, it's awfully stormy and rainy out tonight. I don't know that I really want to go out in that. It could be kind of dangerous. there could be coyotes and stuff up there. What would happen to me if, you see? Or we'll say things like, you know, there's a really good show on television. I just don't want to miss that. Or here's one. Well, I can't do anything about it. I will pray for you, though. Now, listen, I'm not discounting the use of prayer. But James says, James chapter 2, verses 14 through 17, that what use is it, my brethren, when you say you have faith, but you have no works? What use is it if you have faith, but you don't use it? He says, if you see a brother or sister in need, but do nothing for them, and just say, you know what, I wish you well, go on, I'll pray for you. What good is that? The action ought to be accompanied by prayer, not in absence of it. The prayer should not be in absence of the action. Or we'll say things like, well, you know, I just wanted to be sensitive to your feelings, and I thought you might be embarrassed if we came looking, you know, because then other people might see your faults, and, you know, I didn't want to expose all of that. Or we'll say, you know, I wasn't really sure that you were lost anyway. And, you know, it'd probably be judgmental on my part if I thought you were lost or implied that you were lost. Or it would be arrogant of me to say that I am spiritual. After all, we all have our own paths on the journey, right? Well, Jesus talks about this idea of spiritual because Jesus, Paul, and James, they all agree on this process of turning the erring sinner back to the truth and in the right direction. Jesus says, Matthew chapter 18, verses 15 through 17, Jesus says, if you see that your brother or sister is in a sin, you go to them. There's a four-step process that he gives here. It's a four-point sermon within a three-point sermon. You see how I get around that? Four steps here. He says, you go and you show that person's fault to them in private. Well, that way you don't have to embarrass them in front of everybody. If it's a private sin, you caught them, you go to them, you talk to them, you expose it, you say, look, brother, what you're doing is sinful. You need to repent of that. You need to be restored. And he says, if you have been successful, then you have won your brother. You have won his soul. But if he doesn't listen, step two, take two or three witnesses. You take two or three people who have also noticed this activity in his life. And you go and you approach the person with these two or three witnesses. Now, this is the second step. This means that you've already gone yourself. And now you're coming back again, but you're bringing reinforcements. And they're saying, look, you need to know how serious this is. You need to know the risk that you're involved in because your soul is at stake. And we are all here to help you be restored. We want you to repent. We want you to be right with God. Because now you're wandering. And Jesus says, but if he doesn't listen, then you bring it up to the church. You bring it up in the assembly. That's one of the reasons why we gather. We never do it. It is rarely done in the church. Rarely done. And yet Jesus tells us to do it. Because, look, the intent is not to ridicule the one who has sinned. The intent is not to even drive him from the congregation. It is not to embarrass him. It's to restore him. Because it's his soul that we're talking about. We're talking about winning him back to the faith and to the truth. And so you tell it to the church. Let the church go after him, like James says we're supposed to do. Search and rescue. But if he still doesn't listen, then you recognize him as you would a Gentile or a tax collector. You mark it. That's what Jesus says to do. It's a term that we really don't like in the church, disfellowshipping, withdrawing fellowship, marking the erring brother. But listen, whose church is this? Doesn't this church belong to Christ? Isn't it the church of Christ? Therefore, shouldn't we be doing things the way he would have us do it? It's not easy. It's not easy. I've been through that process before, and it's not easy. It's heart-wrenching. A lot of tears are shed. But yet, that's what Jesus tells us to do. That's his process. Paul's instructions are clear. Galatians chapter 6, verses 1 and 2. And this is where Paul says when a brother is in error, he says, you who are spiritual. That's why I said, you know, one of our excuses is, wouldn't it be arrogant of me to say, well, I'm the spiritual one? I mean, after all, when we're talking about this, we're talking about making a judgment, aren't we? But I thought James warned us against judging. Didn't Jesus say in Matthew 7, verses 1 through 5, you judge not, lest ye be judged? That was King James for you. You see? So what do we do here? What do you do when you recognize somebody who is wandering, somebody who's strayed from the truth, and they're in jeopardy of death? Do you have to make a judgment call? Yes, you do. But it's not in the sense that says, look, I'm spiritual and I'm here to fix you. Look, when we're trying to restore somebody, we're not restoring them to our opinion. We're not restoring them to my way of thinking. We're not restoring them to a specific congregation. We're restoring them to the truth. James says if they wander from the truth, we bring them back to what they have wandered away from. And we bring them back to the truth, regardless of my opinion. James tells us that we turn him back. Paul says we do it in a spirit of gentleness. Spirit of gentleness. In 2 Timothy chapter 4, in verse 2, Paul is told to preach the word. Be ready in season and out of season. Rebuke, reprove, and correct, he says, with great patience and instruction. So the one who is spiritual must be one who is able to accurately handle the word of truth. Because otherwise, we just bring somebody to an opinion. You got to be able to use the word to do that. You have to be able to sit down with somebody, open your Bible, and say, look at this. Don't take my word for it, but you look here. I'm not calling it sin, what you're involved in. The Bible says it's sin. God's truth has determined it to be sin. So I want you to come back to this, not to me. Now see, 1 John 1, 7 says, if we walk in the light as he himself is in the light, we do have fellowship one with another. So when you come back to this, you do come back to me. We come back together. We enjoy that fellowship once again, which, by the way, is a whole lot more than just a meal. I just throw that out there, all right? It's a rabbit wanting me to chase him. But Paul also says that in the process of reaching out to others, we've got to watch out for ourselves. Because there's a risk that when you and I go on this search and rescue mission, that we might get caught up in the same things that have tempted that other brother to wander. When we go looking for somebody who's lost up in the woods, there are coyotes and things up there, and so there's risk, and we've got to be aware of that. We've got to be careful of that. We've got to understand what could happen to us when we're out there looking. And so he says, you've got to watch out for yourself. James, I like how Paul and James have so many similarities. Because the primary way that we win somebody back, like Jesus says, we win them back, James says we restore them, it's really through the foolishness of the message that was preached. 1 Corinthians 1, verse 21, Paul says the message of the cross is foolishness. That's not that preaching is foolish. It's the message that is preached that is foolishness. Well, in the eyes of the world who are not being saved by that message, because those who are being saved by the message, it is the power of God. And it's that power of God that can bring somebody back to recognize what is the truth. James says in James 1 and verse 21 that we've got to use the word. We've got to use the word to do that. And that's one of the marks of being spiritual. That's why it's so important for us to grow up in the faith so that we know how to use the word. Because our brethren who are prone to wander are depending on us to use the word. Has anybody done that for you? Have any of you been the ones who have wandered? Somebody's come to you from the church and said, look, we need to talk. We need to study. Your soul's in danger. Has that ever happened to you? Maybe you remember the time when you were lost before you ever became a Christian. And somebody came to you and said, hey, let's study this Bible together. Let's talk about what it means to be a Christian. Let's talk about how we become Christians. And when you saw the truth, you responded and you obeyed. You're buried in the waters of baptism, raised up to walk in newness of life. Sins are forgiven, Holy Spirit deposited. Aren't you glad that person came and spoke to you? Took the time to search and rescue? Because that's what we need. And now, how many of our brethren are waiting on you? Knock on their door. Call them on the phone. Hey, we've missed you. What's going on in your life? Let's get together for lunch. Let's go talk. Let's study together. Let's pray together. Because I'm really concerned for your soul. Is that difficult for us to say? If it is, then we better get over it. Because we have people that are depending upon us. They may not even know it. But listen, God is depending upon us. Because He's the one that gave us the instruction to do it. And He also gives us the blessing of the result. Jesus says that you have won your brother. Paul talks about bearing one another's burdens. And bearing the burden of another's sin brings restoration. It brings reconciliation. It really fulfills that royal law of Christ that James discusses. That royal law to love your neighbor as yourself, to love one another. But we need to bear the sins of another. Perhaps in a similar way to the way Jesus bore our sin. We need to see a personal responsibility in that. Paul says you restore such a one. He talks about having, in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 18 and 19, he talks about having the ministry of reconciliation. Reconciling people who have become lost back to God. And that ministry of reconciliation is the church's main focus today. That ministry of reconciliation is the church's main focus today. That ministry of reconciliation is the church's main focus. That's our main purpose today. Should I say that again? You got the point? James says that when we're successful, we fulfill that royal law of Christ. When we go and when we join in on this search and rescue mission, then we're fulfilling the law of Christ. And James says you can save their soul from death and you can cover a multitude of sins. You know, the idea of covering sin is not a new idea. That's as old as the sacrificial system. Even older. As when animals would be offered for atonement, because atonement simply means covering. And that's where God would cover the sins of the people. And in Jesus, in his atonement, his final sacrifice, the one true sacrifice that covers all sin, there's atonement there. And you bring atonement to people by covering a multitude of sins. 1 Peter chapter 4 and verse 8, he says, love covers a multitude of sins. You see, and we have the opportunity to enable our brethren to enjoy that covering and enjoy the blessings of atonement. But we've got to understand that in this great battle, in this mission of searching and rescuing, we've got to understand that we are God's special agent in seeking out and saving others. Their salvation depends upon it. And you are that special agent. We all are together. We're God's agents of salvation. Now, you might not look like Iron Man. And you might not look like Captain America. And you might not even look like Superman. But you look better than all of that when you're fighting for the salvation of our brothers and sisters and the salvation of those who are lost, those who might be straying and wandering into error, those who are completely outside of Christ. You might be the person that God put in your house, in your neighborhood, to reach somebody there who might be searching. God may have placed you there for a reason, because he knows there's, perhaps it's like Cornelius. He knows there's a Cornelius in your neighborhood just waiting for you to reach out. So we've got to quit using our excuses. Maybe turn our televisions off. Maybe get out and get to know folks and be God's agents. And what we need to do is think souls and think studies. Because when we look at the people around us, don't just see a neighbor. Don't just see a friend. Don't just see a stranger sitting over there in the corner at Starbucks. See a soul with an eternity just like you and me. Maybe some of you in here this morning need to be restored. Maybe you've recognized that you've been wandering and you know you need to get back. The song we're going to sing says, restore my soul. And maybe you know that you need that. Maybe you've not been studying the way that you need to. Maybe you've not been putting forth much effort in growing up in Jesus and in the truth. And you know that you need to get back and get more involved. Maybe get into more Bible study. Maybe even start a Bible study in your home. I mean, there's a great idea. We could do that. I don't know if you knew that or not. We can do that. And maybe get our neighbors to come and join. It might be the neighbor that's waiting on you to invite them. But you know you need to grow up. Maybe you recognize that you have been outside of Christ. You've never been baptized into Christ. And if that's the case, you know you're still in your sin. That's lost. It's the same as a brother wandering from the truth, because death is the only future. But you can change that today. You can be baptized right now. Maybe you know somebody who's wandered from the truth. Maybe we need to pray about that. You can come and ask us to pray for somebody. You don't have to give us the name. I mean, perhaps you've not gone to them personally yet. It wouldn't be right to bring their name up here. But you can say, I've got a friend, I've got a brother that I need to reach out to, and I want the church to pray for me in that effort. That's what you can do. Let's stand together. Let's sing. And whatever you need to do today for yourself to be right with God, and for those whom you love to be right with God, now's the time to act.